call this meeting to order. The Union County Board of Chosen Freeholders, February 20th, 2020 agenda meeting. Call this meeting to order. Mr. Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes, Chairman. Freeholder Garrettson.
Here.
Freeholder Granados.
Here.
Freeholder Hudak. Freeholder Kowalski.
Here.
Freeholder Palmieri Muded.
Here.
Freeholder Staton.
Here.
Freeholder Williams.
Here.
Vice Chairman Estrada.
Present.
And Chairman Mirabella.
Present.
Chairman, you have 8 freeholders present.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Will everyone please rise for the prayer and salute to the flag?
Humbly, we ask God, the giver of peace and the lover of charity, to give the entire family of nations true agreement with his will and to grant the light of his spirit on all who work for justice and peace. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Clerk, please read the statement of compliance with the Open Public Meetings Act.
The chair wishes to announce that pursuant to the requirements of New Jersey statutes annotated Title 10, Chapter 4, Section 10 of the Open Public Meetings Act, adequate notice of this meeting of the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Union has been given by mailing the annual meeting schedule for the year 2020, along with periodic changes necessitated by circumstances, to the newspapers circulating within the County of Union who are designated to receive such notice, and by posting the annual meeting schedule for the year 2020 in the Administration Building, and further by filing the annual meeting schedule for the year 2020 with the Office of the County Clerk.
Thank you very much, Mr. Clerk. We are going to have a few presentations, and I would like to see if Freeholder Staton and Freeholder Kowalski will come forward to present the first two. Okay, I want to call Gwen Ryan, the superintendent of the Union County Vocational Schools, forward. We have a presentation to her on the National Career and Technical Education Day. I can speak for all of the freeholders when I say that this is one of our favorite meetings of the year when we have the students of our VOTEC come represent the schools. I see many of the principals in the back and administrators. My favorite principal, Colleen Gelinella, in the back of the room too, and no offense to the other principals, I love all of you almost equally. But it's wonderful for us to see it, and I know Freeholder Estrada, Freeholder Kowalski, and I, among the other freeholders, but certainly the three of us have been around for a while, and to see those buildings arise and see the opportunity that we've presented to our students in Union County over many, many years, it's just a pure delight to see the end result and the students doing so well and performing so well in these schools and on to college and into their careers. So, Madam Superintendent, I will turn the mic over to you, and if you want to call some of your colleagues up, that would be great too.
Awesome. Thank you. If I could just have all the students that are here tonight with us, and I'm going to introduce them when they get up here, but we do have a number of them, so lots of great things going on at UCVTS. Come on up. Okay, so good evening, and thank you for allowing us to be here this evening. As a Freeholder Chair Mirabella said, this month is the Career and Technical Education Month, and we've been celebrating a lot this month at the Union County Vocational Technical Schools. We've spent the month celebrating through guest speakers, special announcements about influential industry folks, integration of career focus across subject areas, field trips, site visits, job fairs, and this is just to name a few examples. Our schools continue to be an exceptional place to learn and are among the state and nation's best schools. In front of the Freeholder Board, I have put for you one of the rankings that we're most proud of, the K-12 niche rankings that shows that all 5 of our full-time career academies are in the top 50 in New Jersey. Thank you. So specifically, our five schools hold places 3, 8, 9, 14, and 38. So that's something that we're extremely proud of. So in fact, you'll find that our schools do well in many, if not all, of the rankings. We are proud to say that all five of these same full-time career academies are also United States Department of Education National Blue Ribbon Schools of Excellence. So in front of you, you'll find each a blue ribbon pin that we hope that you will wear proudly as a token of our appreciation for all that the Board of Chosen Freeholders does for our school district. So that success is a direct result of your support, and we're so grateful not only to be here in celebration of the students and of the schools, but to say thank you to all of you for the support that you continue to give us. So also as a token of our appreciation, please find tickets to the Academy Performing Arts Spring Production Into the Woods, which will be held April 2nd through 4th. So we hope that you're able to join us. So tonight we have with us a great group of students who would like to introduce you and who we are proud to recognize for their accomplishments in career and technical education. And I also want to take a minute, my administrators are here tonight, if you could just kind of, I would tell you to stand up, but you're already standing, just give a wave. And I wanted to say thank you to them for their hard work that they do every day. So when I call your name for the student, if you could just kind of stand forward and let the Freeholder board see who you are. First, from the Academy for Allied Health Sciences, we have Jennifer Edward. Jennifer is a 12th grade student from Hillside. She's well on her way to achieving her EMT certificate and is currently taking part in an internship in Trinitas Hospital's OBGYN department. So she plans on becoming an OBGYN and is deciding between Rutgers and Seton Hall right now. Victoria Morgan. Victoria is an 11th grade student from Roselle. She has completed in medical spelling for the UCVTS HOSA chapter, which is their career and technical student organization. Victoria is planning a career in nursing and hopes to be an RN to start and is considering pursuing a career in nurse as a nurse practitioner or a professor of nursing. Alora Majumdar. Sorry, Alora. Where are you? Okay. Is a 10th grade student from Fanwood. Alora is an active HOSA participant and has been leading something called Project Happiness, which is an effort to create a new smartphone app to help promote student wellness. So in this effort, Alora has shown vision, creativity, and a desire to use her talents to help others. Also from the Academy for Allied Health Sciences, we have Raj Bhatt. Raj is a 12th grade student from Plainfield. He is the State Northern Regional Vice President of HOSA and is also a certified EMT before he graduates. Raj's future goal is to become a trauma surgeon. He's double majoring in public health and pre-med at Johns Hopkins next year.
All right.
From the Academy for Information Technology, I have three students that I'm going to introduce together for an award that they've recently received. Alex Carey, Selson Gutkowski, and Meredith Rosenthal. Meredith is from Westfield, Selson is from Linden, and Alex is from Scotch Plains. They competed last week as a team and took second place at the State J.A. Titan Challenge. The J.A. Titan Challenge requires students to take on the role of a corporate business leader by making decisions to steer their business to success. So, to earn a second place slot, these three AIT juniors defeated 260 students competing against them. So certainly something to be proud of. Right. Next, also from the Academy for Information Technology, we have Tunmiche Ulabi. So Tunmiche is a Roselle student among 400 young women recognized for technological achievements by the National Council for Women in Technology. In March, Tunmiche will represent UCVTS at the FBLA State Leadership Conference when she competes in web design. Yep. Alexa Fazio and Devin Botany. Again, we're going to introduce them together. Alexa and Devin are both from Fanwood. Alexa is an AIT sophomore. Devin is an AIT junior. This year, these two young individuals co-directed a community chapter of Girls Who Code, partnering with a member of AIT's advisory board. The Girls Who Code chapter comprised of Scotch Plains Fanwood middle school students, and the girls meet weekly at the Scotch Plains Fanwood, or the Fanwood Public Library. So Devin and Alexa planned the curriculum for the program and assisted in the instruction for them to develop their final projects, games, chatbots, animations, and websites. From the Academy for Performing Arts, we have Fiona Morales. Fiona's a student from Kenilworth. She's a junior theater major at the Academy for Performing Arts. She's been working hard this month to complete a project called Dramaturgy, okay, where she had to rewrite and direct a play of her choice. Fiona chose to tackle the topic of immigration by reimagining the play A Zoo Story by Edward Albee. Her experiences gave her great insight into the multiple roles that a performing artist must take on, including that of a writer, director, and of an actor. So from the Magna High School for Science, Mathematics, and Technology, we have student Ryan Brown. Ryan is a junior who is planning on majoring in biomedical engineering in college. He is an active participant of the Technology Student Association. He was a member of the biomimicry team that placed third in the state and a member of the Technology Bowl, a team that placed second in the state, as well as participating in nationals last year. So at the Springs TSA competitions, Ryan will again be competing in biomimicry, biotechnology, and engineering design this year. From UC Tech, we have Caitlin Labatan. She's an 11th grade Teacher Education Academy student from Linden who is planning to further her education in psychology. She hopes to work as a school psychologist someday in the near future. Caitlin's also participated in their CTSO Educator Rising and has earned a gold medal in Skills USA opening and closing team in 2019. All right. So we have Ivona Saro. She's an 11th grade student, also from the Teacher Education Academy. She's from Elizabeth. She's been involved in the Educator Rising for 3 years. She's the current president of the organization. She is an international gold medal recipient in the Creative Writing Problem Solving Competition. And last but certainly not least, we have Shannon McCarthy. Shannon, thank you. Shannon is a senior from Cranford. She will be representing her class and competing in the Skills USA Early Childhood Education Competition on March 5th in Mercer County. She'll be attending Montclair State University in the fall and studying psychology and also early childhood education. Awesome. So once again, on behalf of the entire UCVTS community, we're so grateful for all of your support and thankful to be able to bring these students here tonight to make you proud.
Thank you.
Okay, our next presentation is also vocational school related for the future farmers of America. I have a quick story to tell, and you know, Union County is not necessarily known as a farming county. However, my son who went to AIT was part of FFA, and it took great pride in coming in seventh in the state in turf management. And he put that right up with some of his wrestling championships that he was most proud of, winning that award. And he reminds us to this day that he is a farmer at heart. So let me turn it over to the superintendent. We'll invite the other students, and I know the teachers here too.
Okay, so if I could have Mrs. Baldassar join us, and then Aaron, Owen, and Lucia, please. Thank you. So during the week of February 22nd to 29th, that's this year, 2020, UCVTS will also be celebrating National FFA Week. So from the Union County Vocational Technical School's FFA chapter, we have three students with us here tonight, along with their outstanding advisor, Mrs. Bonnie Baldassar. So to introduce the student, we have Lucia Moriello, who's a UC Tech junior in the culinary program from Berkeley Heights. She serves as the 1920 secretary for the Union County FFA chapter. And in celebration of FFA Week on February 27th, Lucia will be attending the 2020 NJ New Jersey FFA Advocacy and Legislative Leadership Day at the College of New Jersey. Awesome. So Lucia's also received many recognitions in local and state competitions, including being named a Borlaug Scholar as a part of the 2019 New Jersey Youth Institute World Food Prize, and receiving the New Jersey FFA Chapter Growing Leader Award in 2018.
All right.
Yeah. So on the end, we have Aaron Etienne, and he's a 2016 graduate of our horticulture program. But we would like you to know that Aaron, in 2019, was an American FFA degree recipient. And so he and Mrs. Baldassar in October attended the 92nd National FFA Convention. Aaron is one of three Union County FFA members in the 38-year history of our chapter to earn the highest degree the FFA bestows on its members. So Aaron was featured in a national article, Ag News, highlighting the impact FFA and career and technical education has on its students. So we're very proud of him. And finally, we have Owen Miller, who's a ninth grade student, just starting off with us. He's from Roselle Park and attends the School of Sustainable Sciences as part of UC Tech. So he is a FFA member and will be competing this spring in the Skills USA Pathways Agriculture Contest. So we look forward to a big win there too. So we thank you all.
So I just want to let everybody know that Freeholder Kowalski was given the state honorary degree this past June and or May, and I could share with you what they said. Okay, the State FFA Association. Thank you for your support to the Union County FFA chapter. Your service as a Union County freeholder has encouraged growth within Union County Technical Schools and the Union County FFA chapter. You recognize the value of partnerships and work hard to ensure organizations and individuals with common interests share resources and programs. Because of this, many Union County FFA members have benefited and have been inspired to become more active in both the community and the FFA chapter. Your commitment to environmental initiatives aligns perfectly with the mission of the Sustainable Science Academy Program of Study at Union County Tech. For your unwavering support to the Union County FFA chapter and to Food, Agriculture, and Natural Resources Education Program, we are honored to present you the Honorary State FFA degree. So, there was a freeholder meeting that night, so she was unable to attend the state convention, and one of the past alumni students accepted on her behalf. But she did come to our FFA banquet and was able to get honored by a state FFA officer. And then two other, we had two first place winners this year at the fall CDEs. So we had a first place individual, Michael Noel, 2020 State Fruits and Vegetables Career Development Event, and Michael Lombach, our chapter president, was first place individual in the State FFA Milk Quality and Products Career Development Event, which Lucia was also a member of that team. So, one more thing. So, in addition, Michael Lombach was selected to represent New Jersey at the Global Youth Institute in Iowa. So he and I attended this October. And there was an article both on him and the article that Aaron was featured in, and we brought copies for you. So thank you for having us and recognizing FFA Week, and thanks. Bye-bye.
Sorry, Freeholder Kowalski, I don't have one of these for you, but congratulations, you're a farmer too. For this next presentation, I'd like to call the Vice Chairman forward to come with me. Vice Chairman Estrada. And while the Vice Chairman is coming up, I'd like to just say this is a very special resolution that we're handing out tonight. Someone who's dedicated her life to service in the Township of Union and in Union County, and that's Sally Strauss. And Sally, will you come forward? Coming up, I'm going to invite Senator Cryan and Anthony Russo to come forward too. Senator and former Senator Russo and Township Mayor, thank you guys for being here. So Sally, first of all,
thank you.
We're so proud of you and your contributions. When we heard of everything that you do for Union, not only do we see it because you're all over the place. One of the charter members of the Union County Means Business events and doesn't miss that, and helps out so much around the county, contributing to Union's success and the success of our county. We're just delighted to be able to give you this resolution, just some small token of our appreciation for all that you've done over decades of service. So thank you very much.
It's my pleasure.
It's a pleasure. I'm going to ask if Senator Cryan doesn't mind to say a couple words. I'd love it, Senator.
I'm sure you would, Al. Thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you to Freeholder Mirabella, to Freeholder Estrada, and to all the board. By the way, happy birthday, Freeholder Hudak. All right. So I'm honored to be here with two treasures of the Township of Union. Gentleman to my left is a former senator and former mayor, someone who led our community with vision and a legacy that continues to this day, where he continues to serve people in need as our county adjuster. And the lady to my right, who's a legend in the Township of Union, she has a card, if you should get one before you leave, that says, if it happened in Union, how's it go, Sally?
If it happens in Union, I'm either in it, on it, or know about it.
Okay. And that is our treasure in Union, a visionary leader and a visionary member of our community who's made such a difference, whether it's in religious organizations such as the one she worships in, or in our library board where she's been a long-term member, or our business community where she's been part of the CID, the Chamber of Commerce. As she mentioned to you before, if it happened in Union, it's because she was a part of it. And that's why I'm here tonight along with the senator and the mayor to be a part of a celebration that is Sally Strauss, because she celebrates everything that's wonderful about the Township of Union. So congratulations.
Thank you so very much. Good evening, everyone. You're very fortunate due to the fact that I am never at a loss for words. I'm only going to say a few. First of all, thank you so very much to the Freeholders. Thank you to all of my special guests that are here this evening. I am truly, truly honored to receive this recognition. It is always my pleasure to serve, to be a part of everything, and I would encourage our audience also, always be a part of things. One of my other favorite sayings is, you have to step up to stand out. I live my life stepping up, and I would say, based on this evening's recognition, apparently I stand out. But it is my pleasure, and I thank you so very much.
The pearls of wisdom just flow so easily from your mouth.
Just real quick, we want to thank Marie McGuire from BCB Bank, who's friends with Sally, TV Tody Brennan, who's our legacy leader in the Union community for TV, and Katie and Pat Higgins, who are longtime friends of Sally's as well, for joining us. So thanks so much. Thank you, Freeholder.
Thank you very much. Keep up the great work. I'd like to call up Freeholder Mudead to help me with this next presentation. So it's now my honor to call up Dan Sullivan from the Scotch Plains Rescue Squad. Dan, come forward. So Dan, I have this resolution for you in celebration of your 50 years of dedicated service to the Scotch Plains Rescue Squad. Amazing, amazing. And I am fortunate enough to get to see you in action day in and day out throughout the community. And I know how much you give back and how much time you spend helping others and contributing. And your wife does the same too in her own capacity, and the family that's here. So I couldn't let this pass without recognizing you publicly for 5 decades of service. You know, you feel like you've been a Freeholder for a little while, and then you see somebody who's done 50 years of service. That's just amazing. And I know the Rescue Squad honored you, and I wanted to make sure this county honored you for your dedicated service. So thank you very much, Dan. Appreciate it. Good work.
I'd just like to thank everybody. I'd like to thank my family for putting up with me, for allowing me to do this. I know they married into this, but, you know, I give up a lot, but they give up a lot, too. So it's really my family that supports all of this. Not only this family, but my SWAT family. And I'm one of the older ones in the squad. But Raj Blatt, that was over here with the College of AIT, is actually rides with me on Tuesday nights. So it's you've got the older and the younger, and it's the volunteer effort that we hope to continue. And we want to thank Al Mirabella, being our township administrator. He's been a very good supporter for the Rescue Squad. I really appreciate everything he does.
Thank
you. So, thank
appreciate
you.
That. Thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Thank you.
Real quick, come on.
All right, Mr. Clerk, as Senator Cryan indicated, I want to make sure you know that Freeholder Hudak has joined the dais. Thank you, Freeholder, and happy birthday.
Thank you.
Duly noted, Chairman.
Okay, the regular meeting agendas are being handed out now that the presentations are over, so you'll have them momentarily. We'll wait just a minute. All right, so now we have a presentation to the board, Janu Solutions, and I'll turn it over to Director Anderson to set it up, and then we'll have that presentation. Thank you, Director.
Thank you, Chair and members of the board. This evening, Janu Solutions is in to give us our findings for the 2019 Community Needs Assessment. This was established in 2019, and now we are at the time that they have the findings and recommendations. So I would like to invite up, next slide. I would like to invite Tom Blattner and Gina Haranis up from Janu Solutions to discuss, you know, what's our future, what were the findings, and where do we go from here? Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, Freeholder, thank you so much for your support and inspiration, and this has been an amazing experience for us to get out into the community and learn about the issues in Union County. I'd also like Gina Haranis, our vice president, who is the project manager, is going to be part of the presentation, but I wanted to thank Georgine Trinkle, who gathered data from about 90 different sources to put the data together, and John Childress, who was gathering all the human information through all the focus groups, so I want to thank them as well. Basically, the way we undertook this needs assessment was we established a steering committee of people from all over the county, from all different walks of life, from all different interests, all different demographics, and they worked very closely with us in throughout this process. We followed a family and individual success approach, which I'll explain in a minute. We developed a mountain of data to look at from different sources in the community. But I think most importantly, we were able to reach out to people in the community to get their views about what their needs are and what's going well, and then we were able to formulate findings and recommendations. The approach that we have developed over the years is pretty simple. There are basic things that anybody needs to have a good shot, a decent shot at a good life, and that we are all born, we go through the very early years, we're in the school age years, we go through adulthood, and then we enter our older years like myself. And there are four basic things that anybody needs. One is strong family relationships and community connections, safety and financial security, health and well-being, and lifelong learning and education. And there's some mix of those things that occur throughout your life that either give you a good shot or not. And that's the way that we organize all of our data and the questions and the way that we talk to community folks about this. And then the other thing that a lot of needs assessments do is they gather information, but they don't have a way of understanding whether, you know, sort of a litmus test for it. So without going through all the goals, but we've established goals for each stage of the life journey. For example, for young kids, the goal is every child will enter school safe, healthy, ready to learn, and we go through the whole life journey. So there's some framework to understand how well things are going. And then we had a, in terms of the participation of the community, and this is always interesting when we start these processes, because we've been into communities where we're just using data and we're tracing, running around all over the place trying to find people to talk to. And one of the things that Director Anderson had asked us to look at is to what extent is the Union County community ready to mobilize to take on some pretty significant change since some of the issues that we have uncovered. And I will tell you that I've been doing this a long time, and the degree to which the members of your community from all over the place, you know, from every angle, jumped into this and participated in it has really been amazing. We've had 983 people from around the community who have participated in this process. We had 446 people respond to surveys. We had 33 focus groups with 300 people involved in focus groups. We met with all the planning body groups, key informants. So we had a massive participation and sort of mobilization throughout the community, which gives us a lot of confidence in terms of what the findings are. And I'm going to ask Gina Hernandez to come up and quickly go through the findings.
Okay, thank you. We have separated our findings into populations that seem to rise to the top and we have some concerns about, to conditions where there are some concerns, and to some communities that we want to talk to you about. So if we look at our major findings in terms of populations, these are our populations of highest concern in the county. We've identified these populations, first of all, because we are very concerned, as I'm sure all of the board is, about individuals who are living in poverty. You do have about 57,000 people living in the county in poverty. 10,000 of those are children. Many people in the county, however, are doing very well, as you know. But those that are living in poverty do rise to the top. You've also got a large population who are non-English speaking, many of whom are undocumented, who it makes it very difficult for them to access services. We've got seniors and those with disabilities, of course, who have some special needs, very young children with special needs also, individuals with substance use disorder. As you know, across the state, this is a growing problem. Union County is not immune from this. We have grandparents raising grandchildren, about 14% of grandparents are raising grandchildren. And then we have a special issue around children that are in foster care in this county for over 5 years. It's the highest number in the state, and it's something that you'll hear we're going to recommend there be some pursuit about. So as we move through, just to give you a little more information, when we look at our family relationship and community connections, this goes right into our issue around the child abuse and neglect statistics for the county. So while the number of investigations seem to remain around 4,000 in the county, it is that concern around those children that are in placement for long periods of time. We also have concerns that were unmet needs around some child care issues related to affordable child care, summer care, after school care, and tutoring. We have issues related to transportation that were raised, and issues around how individuals know about and are able to access the many resources that do exist in the county. I just want to point out to you as we go through these slides, there are boxes on the right. And the findings that we had from the surveys, the 446 surveys and the 300 people in focus groups were very, very similar. So that's why we highlighted those in each of these areas. So moving along to personal safety and financial security, housing was the number one issue that came up in the county. Again, I'm sure not a surprise to the freeholders. Issues related to access, affordability, and availability. We heard a lot of data. We've even heard the very recent stories about thousands of families from New York being dumped into this county and others in northern New Jersey that are causing some issues. Again, people are doing generally very well in the county. However, there are some individuals that are not doing so well. The median income is over $77,000 in the county, but the Institute that looks at the cost of living, the Economic Policy Institute, estimates that it takes almost $93,000 to live comfortably in Union County. So there are some concerns there. And then there are some areas where violent and nonviolent crime are of a concern. Moving along to health and well-being, again, I want to emphasize the substance use disorder, and particularly because there are no inpatient substance use disorder treatment facilities in the county. You have folks that are working very hard together in the county to form a continuum, but you clearly have some pieces of that continuum that are not in place that cause your residents to go outside to try to enter into recovery. There is also stigma associated still with substance use disorder. And there are a number of issues related to the ability of particularly non-English speaking residents to access medical services, dental care, vision care, et cetera. And again, some of your undocumented population really raised issues around not having health care coverage. Moving on to learning and education, a couple of findings there that were significant. People did talk about needing good training to get good jobs. And we all know that the unemployment rate, thankfully, is relatively low, but we still have populations that are struggling with that. You have some schools in the district that are struggling to meet some of the standards. And the other issue that was raised related to education was very interesting. We got this mainly from focus groups that many individuals in the county look to school personnel for help. If they're having a problem with their family or their child, sometimes the first place they go and talk to are the people at the schools. The feedback that we got was some of the personnel there could be more knowledgeable about the services that exist in the county. So those are sort of our conditions of concern. Now let me speak for a moment about the communities in the county. This was a very interesting topic, and we wanted to take a look because we knew that so many communities are doing so very well in the county that we looked at a myriad of factors. And for every community that we are going to highlight as a community where there are really significant opportunities for some improvement, there were different factors that arose. In some communities, it was unemployment. In some, it was crime. In some, it was grandparents raising grandkids. In some, it was areas of poverty in the communities. So a combination of that community input, opinion, and the discussion that we had with the steering committee chose us to sort of categorize some communities in this way. As you can see, your longest list is communities that are really holding their own in the county, that are doing very well. We have a few communities where there are starting to be some emerging needs that we're beginning to get concerned about, and we have a lot of data in our full report around all of that. But if you look at the next slide, there are really some communities that we want to highlight that we want to term communities of opportunity, where we think there are the greatest opportunities for improvement in some of those areas of support for the residents of those communities. And if you look at our next slide, we list those communities. You see them listed down the right-hand side. And these are basically some of the things that cause us to highlight those communities and have them be areas of focus. Things like the income disparity, some graduation rates, substance abuse, health care, the grandparents issue, the foreign-born residents, and the unemployment issue. So those were our findings, which lead us now to the recommendations. I'm going to turn the podium back over to Tom.
Thanks, Gina. In terms of the recommendations, and we have a whole bunch of recommendations, and I'm not going to run through all of them tonight because you're very busy and you got a full agenda, but I would like to invite you possibly to the community forum next week, where there's going to be 2.5 hours of going into all these recommendations in detail with the community. So, and I also want to thank, because a number of you had participated in different aspects of this survey, and your interest has made this, a much more valuable experience, I think, for everybody who's been involved. So I'm just going to give you a couple of highlights, and then, going to be presenting the full findings at this community forum. And I would also like to say, if there are any particular issues that you want to learn more about or have questions about, then we are certainly available to come to meet with you on an individual basis. So in terms of the findings, they sort of fell into two different areas. One was there's certain needs that are unmet. For example, this issue of not being a in-county opioid treatment program, that's just like an unmet need that needs to happen. But a lot of the findings had to do with you have incredible resources out there. I mean, there are providers and volunteers and different groups that emerge through this process, and you are a extremely resource-rich county. However, it's not as organized as it could be. So our two major recommendations are, how is anybody going to find out where they go for help? And right now, there is not one single good, up-to-date, online resource directory. So one of our recommendations is just, let's do that. Put a online, up-to-date, real-time resource directory together that people from all these different walks of life can access and find out where they can go for resources. There are some people in the community that don't use computers, so there have to be other means of getting information out there. And then thirdly, Director Anderson has already started an action line because there are a lot of people who need to talk to somebody if they're trying to find what they need. So that was one example of trying to organize things a little more efficiently and effectively for residents. I think the second one is this idea that for a lot of the challenges we found, all these pieces of services and how people access services and sort of you need to go from here to there for services, they can be organized. And one of the members of the steering committee called the Yellow Brick Road. So if you're somebody who is in need of a service, how do you access it? how do you go from one component of the service to the next? And this doesn't cost money. It costs people getting together and organizing differently and cooperating differently. So that's, you know, probably the major recommendation we're making. And without going through all the different areas, whether it's homelessness and housing and creating an organized system for people who are homeless, whether it's looking at poverty and income disparity from a systems point of view, on and on, health and behavioral health. Even if you get an inpatient facility, people are going to have to get from the inpatient facility to outpatient work, which is a major gap throughout the state. There's this idea of organizing services that are already there in a way that people can use them better. So, and that was a major, major finding. We did identify some strategies for certain populations, children and youth, Gina mentioned. Disabled adults, we had some very, very interesting conversations. LGBTQ population, and Freeholder, that's, you know, your work on that is just outstanding throughout the state. There are some unmet needs there. And then mobilizing around communities of opportunity, because there are some models about place-based collective impact work where the leadership in a local community comes together and starts tackling problems together with support from other levels of government. So the final slide is this idea of looking into the future together. And one of the things that we have to be very careful about is if a community is not ready to do these recommendations, it's going to be a disaster. You start asking people who look at one another with suspicion, and they think that all they're going to do is compete with one another. And if they try to help somebody, they're going to lose. What we found through this entire process, that Union County is amazingly positioned to take on a collective impact process. You are going to need some new resources, and we make recommendations for resources from outside of county government, because there's no way you can afford to do this this by yourselves. We have recommendations around federal opportunities, about state opportunities, philanthropy. But I think our biggest finding is can Union County mobilize a collective impact process to start tackling these problems together? And every single group that we talked to, whether they were small groups, wherever, whatever the community they came from, whatever the demographics were, everybody is ready to roll. So I think the strength that we found in your community are the people who live here. So thank you very much, and I hope we can see you on the community forum. Okay. Thanks great. A lot.
Thank you. Well, yes. Let me thank you for this roadmap now that we have, and I have no doubt that taking this roadmap, working with Director Anderson, the county manager, and our partners in the community, we'll be able to work through this and hopefully improve the lives of our residents. At this time, if you don't mind, I'll open it up to any questions that the freeholders may have. Maybe there is, maybe there isn't, but I wanted to give them the opportunity to see if anybody had any comments or questions. Anybody? Okay. Well, Freeholder Kowalski.
Chairman, I just want to say that thank you for the great work, and I know that we are going to tackle these problems, and I heartily agree with you that the resources of our community are the people, and we just need to make it easier for them to connect with each other for what needs to be done. So I am confident we'll move in that direction, and I will attend the session later. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you. Freeholder Williams.
Hi. I echo Freeholder Kowalski's thoughts. I just had a question regarding the feedback you've got for the upcoming forum. Have you gotten all the municipalities involved and engaged? Are the municipal officials all coming or sending designees? Yeah? Okay.
Yeah, they've all been notified, and there are all different ways of getting out to them. And also, there are a number of state officials who are going to come to hear this and participate on the panel, because I think that this, we're trying to get this, this is only going to work if everybody's in this together. So that's
Thank you. Awesome. Thank you.
Freeholder Kowalski.
If I could add my thanks to our fabulous human services staff as well. I think that you, our Janus folks will will agree that Debbie Ann Anderson and all of her team, I see Christina Topolowski is here, our staff go above and beyond, and it is a huge task that never ends. So I just want to thank all of them for the great work that they do.
I just have one last question. So I know you put our communities in different categories, let's say well-performing, emerging issues, and it needs improvement, basically, for lack of a better term. I imagine there was metrics associated with that to be able to put that into place, and I wonder if after a year, if there's any kind of follow-up that can be done on those communities. So I'll ask you to comment, or I'll put it on Director Anderson's desk to kind of keep us apprised of progress.
I mentioned this idea of place-based collective impact, and the idea behind that is you get everybody in the community together, and we have, as I mentioned, 90 sources of data that are very specific to communities, and then we have a lot of input from community members. So if you're going to do a place-based collective impact initiative, you're going to start with, this is what we're trying to do through a planning process, and then you're going to, a year later, you're going to measure whether the impact has occurred. Okay. All right. And that's something that doesn't happen in this industry.
Good.
So yeah. That's key to that, and I thank you
all
for
right,
that.
All right, that's fine, yeah, because I don't want it to be that we just did this study and then it's kind of gets put on a shelf. I want it to be an active living document. The county manager knows that, and I'm sure the directors know that too.
Absolutely.
All right, very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to move in the next meeting to the approval of communications, and now we'll get into the departments. I want to start with the Department of Economic Development. Deputy County Manager is out ill and thankfully has decided to stay home and not share her illness. So I appreciate the Deputy County Manager's thought process with that. But with that, I'll invite Director Scutari to answer any questions on the Deputy County Manager.
The Department of Economic Development has one resolution. I'll try and answer any questions.
Freeholder Granados.
Thank you, Chair. Can you just elaborate on the services that are going to be provided?
Sure. This is a contract that's been in place since 2013. They provide an employee that works in the IT department during our normal business hours, and they also monitor our servers for 24/7, and we have over 90 servers countywide. And any technical work or network infrastructure support and computer security issues that may come up, they help our IT department as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Thank you, Director. We'll move to Director Graziano, Department of Engineering, Public Works, and Facilities Management.
Good evening, Chairman. Good evening. Freeholders. The department has six resolutions on tonight for your consideration. I'll try and answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Director. Any questions for the Director? Vice Chairman.
Yes, Director. Sir. In number two, it shows that we have approximately 9.2, or you're going to replace a guardrail in the area of 9.26 miles. Where do we have that kind of quantity of guardrail?
It's all through our reservation, basically, and any other roads. This is just the design for it. This is not the construction for it. Yeah, we were informed by the state that all of our guide rails are out of compliance. They're a little too low now, because when those were built and those were installed years ago, you didn't have as many SUVs as we have now currently. So the state's been going around and getting everybody that's out of compliance. So they sent us a letter a few months back. So we had to go out to RFP for this. And
did they also send a check to help?
No, they didn't. So this is only the design. What I'm assuming is about $100,000 a mile, $100,000 a mile. So maybe about $1 million, a little more than $1 million. I'm thinking when it comes out.
Let's make sure that we recycle the scrap metal, please.
Of course.
I'll wheel to Joanne to make sure that you do that.
Oh, I will.
Very good, Vice Chairman. Thank you. Anybody else? Director, thank you.
Thank you, Chairman.
Department of Finance, Director Taylor.
Good
Good evening, Chairman and members of the board. The Department of Finance has three resolutions for your consideration this evening, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Thank you, Director. Any questions for Director Taylor? Nope. All right. Thank you, Director. We'll move on to the Department of Human Services. Director Anderson.
Good evening, Chair and members of the board. The Department of Human Services has 10 resolutions on. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Great. Freeholder Mudet.
Thank you, Chair. Director, could you just elaborate on number 8 and number 9, please,
yeah,
and what those online programs are?
Number 8 is Career Edge. It is a online workforce development activity that teaches the youth how to interview, so mock interviews and stuff like that. It's everything run online on Skype. It's no other companies in New Jersey are doing it. That's why when it was recommended by Department of Labor, we jumped on it to try it as a pilot. The life, live life virtually. Number 9 is a virtual reality also for youth going through workforce development. What's the reality of life when it's budgeting and getting into college? If you don't choose college, what about going to trade schools and others? So it's really a virtual aspect. So you have an avatar and it guides you through how do you budget? What do you pay for application? Do you pay for gas? Do you pay for rent? So it's a holistic approach. So that's 8 and 9.
Thank you. Okay. Any questions additionally? Vice Chairman Estrada.
Yes, thank you. On number 7, which is the IDRC, so presently we're contracting with Provincial Links to run the program for us. Is that what we're doing?
Currently, we are. Prevention Links run the program. Last year, we had a team member that retired. And because it is a state mandate and a very strict requirements and who can do the program, the individual that does do it through Prevention Links have all the certifications needed to be successful.
Okay. VC, thank you. Anybody else? All right. Director, thank you.
Thank you.
Department of Parks and Recreations, Director Zuber.
Good evening, Chairman and Freeholders. Department of Parks and Recreation has 2 items on tonight's agenda, and I'll try to answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Director. Any questions for Director Zuber? Nope. Okay, Director, thank you.
Thank you.
Office of the County Council, County Council Barry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Office of the County Council has 6 items on tonight's agenda, and I would be happy to answer any questions for the mayor.
Thank you, sir. Any questions for the County Council? All right, thank you. Office of the County Manager, County Manager Oatman.
Thank you, Chairman. I have one item on tonight's agenda. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, any questions for the County Manager? Okay, very good, thank you. Freeholder-sponsored resolutions, any comments? Freeholder Mudet.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to be added to number 11 and number 12, please.
Okay, very good. Please do that. Mr. Clerk, please note that. Anybody else? Okay, with that, then I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved by Freeholder Kowalski, seconded by Freeholder Mudet. Can I have a roll call?
Yes, Chairman. Chairman Garrett, Freeholder Garrison?
Yes.
Freeholder Granados?
Yes.
Freeholder Hudak?
Yes.
Freeholder Kowalski?
Yes.
Freeholder Palmieri Mudet?
Yes.
Freeholder Staten?
Yes.
Freeholder Williams?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Estrada?
Yes.
And Chair Mirabella?
Aye.
Chairman, you have 9 votes in the affirmative.
Good, very good. We're adjourned the first meeting. Mr. Clerk, do you need a couple of minutes in between?
May I have 2 minutes?
Yep, we'll take 5 minutes in between, and then we'll start our next meeting.
Okay.